Hello, everyone. Welcome to the 14th edition of Fusion EP Talks. Today, we are going to have a talk from Jose, who is the 2019 graduate in Fusion EP program. And his talk is going to be on design of extruder for pellet injection for the demo. So let's welcome Jose. Yeah, Jose, the stage is yours. You can start.
Okay, thank you, Francis. Hello, everybody. As my colleague says, I did this work during my master thesis, and it was in the Karlsruher Institute for Technologie, and it is about the considerations for a design of an injector of fuel for the demo reactor that will be built up in some years. We prefer as soon as possible. Well, as the motivation, I present here some some points that move us to do this kind of work. First is the solid pellets are necessary for fusion because the mass requires to be in the center of the plasma where the hot and the pressure is higher, and it is more efficient to deposit the fuel to produce fusion. Also, this fuel is diffused around the core of the plasma, so it is always better to have it the point of fueling in this core of the plasma. And the better way to produce these particles in the center of the plasma is the solid launch of pellets. And in this case, we consider DT mixtures. This means that the pellets are composed by deuterium and tritium because this is the most favorable reaction for fusion. The design of this kind of injectors already for a commercial or industrial scale is not developed, so it needs a lot of work, a lot of design, a lot of experiments. And this is the reason also because it needs more studies and more considerations. This will be the first European design in the case of injectors of pellets for fusion devices, because previous come from the USA and Russia. And I'm going to start. We can see here like a small example how the pellets go through the plasma in the ASDEX. This is in the ASDEX upgrade tokamak in Garching. Well, what I did first was a flow chart diagram to see what I have and what I require to design and consider the injector and the extruder. We will see. The first point is to know the product, and as we know, the product of deuterium tritium is not very popular or not very well known, so I had to make a material research. And afterwards, when I get enough information, I come with the rheological properties of this material. So when I had the rheological properties, I have to define a mass flux depending on the requirements of demo and the performance of the mass transport from the injector to this core of the plasma. And once I did all this, I will be able to calculate the pressure in the nozzle of the injector because I know the amount of mass and flux that is going out of the extruder. And finally, I complete this research work with the technology analysis to determine, with all these characteristics and all these statements, which extrusion or which system is better for the case of deuterium tritium. Well, this is the first part of the work, the research. I have to look for these properties on the liquid and solid phase, because the in the injector the material comes in a liquid form, and during the extrusion of the material it becomes solid, and finally it is pumped out by this nozzle I was commenting previously. And to calculate how are the thermodynamics and the fluid dynamics in this machine, first is to know all these properties as viscosity, heat capacities, thermal conductivities. All of these are important factors and data that are necessary for make the design. Well, this is what I found. We can see here like three molecules. One is for deuterium, the other is tritium, and the other is DT. And the reason is because the DT gas has the fraction, the molar fraction we can see in the bottom of the image. It is 25% deuterium, another 25% tritium, and 50% DT. This is like the stable mixture of the gas of DT. And you cannot, I mean, if you take pure DT, it will divide and it forms these proportions. So these are the three molecules I had to consider in my material, in the molar fractions I present. And now going to the details, you can see that the deuterium, for example, I found all the data I described in the previous slide, but for deuterium tritium molecules and tritium molecules, I had to extrapolate some data using one known system, that is the quantum parameter. The quantum parameter is something that I found in the Sauer's book, and it's like one method to calculate this kind of characteristics of the materials using the existing characteristics, for example, in deuterium and hydrogen. And when I say hydrogen, I mean protium. Well, and I make this with these three elements a final, let's say, characteristic. This is just an example of the saturated liquid densities depending on the temperature. As we can see, for lower temperatures, the liquid has more density. And if we see the green line, the green line is the result of applying the proportion in the molar fraction I talked before. And the other three lines are the three different molecules present in the DT mixture. Well, this is the next step, the rheological characteristics. I have found that in the liquid phase, the material I am talking about behaves like a Newtonian fluid, which means that it's practically not compressible and has a very low viscosity. And the point is, when it becomes solid, then the rheological characteristics change, because as solid, it behaves like a non-Newtonian fluid. And the model that describes the behavior of this material is the Herschel-Bulkley model. This model, we can see here a plot with the shear stress and the shear rate, where the equation of the model is defined there, depending on the yield shear stress, a consistency constant, key, and the shear thinning, that is the gamma, dot gamma. And this shear thinning has a low index of n, I mean, no, the gamma, sorry, the gamma is the shear rate. And this shear rate has a low index of 0.5. And when this low index is lower than one, it means like the material is a shear thinning material. What this means, in resume, that the material, when it becomes solid, it behaves like a toothpaste. So you require this yield shear stress to pump out the material, and when it goes through a pipe or a tube, like in the example, it has a thinning due to the pressure that is applied to the material. Well, this is the point where I found, this is the paper where I found the data about the material of deuterium. Here, these lines, this line particularly represent the deuterium shear strength depending on the temperature. And using this reference and the method I commented before, I was able to calculate the deuterium-tritium shear strength and the tritium shear strength to make afterwards the simulation of the process. Well, now I have to define the output that is going to be injected. And to define this, I need the mass requirements in the core of demo that is presented here, and the transport performance. With the transport performance, I know the amount of particles I need in the start of the circuit to found or reach the goal in the end of the circuit, that is the core of the plasma. And once I know the number of particles per second that I have to produce in the injector, depending on the temperature that the injection is going to be, already very low temperatures to get it frozen, I will know the volume, and also this is the part of the assumptions, I will know the volume using the DT fraction and using the number of particles. Well, also I introduce some other assumptions as the rate of pellets per second. In this case will be 20 pellets because it was estimated already like this, but it can change. And using 4 injectors. This is also important because as long as we have more injectors, the injectors will have more reliability to produce the pellets instead of, for example, if we have one fail in one of the injectors and we only produce the mass injection for one extruder or one injector, and we have problems with this injector, then the reaction can stop suddenly and the feeding will not be constant. But by the way of divide the fueling by 4, we can still produce in plasma if the other 3 injectors are still working. Well, I have a lot of details to comment. Then, as I told before, I define a temperature that the material comes in this case 22 Kelvin, and I define another temperature that goes out, and in this case it will be 14 Kelvin. This is only an example because for this presentation I use one particular example, but the point is that the work I did in the simulation, you can change the temperatures, change the values. Of course, there are some core values that should not be changed because our experimental data, like the densities that are used for make this final design and calculate the optimal geometries. With the pellets, with the frequency of the pellets and the number of particles, we can calculate the mass of each pellet, and with this mass we can calculate the geometries of the pellet, because we want a pellet that has the same diameter as height. And for this calculation, we only use one data, that is the radius. And with this radius and the calculus of this geometry of the pellet, the optimal geometry, let's say, we can calculate also the output velocity. If we have the length of the pellet in a cylindrical shape and we multiply by 20 pellets, we get the length is going to be extruded per second, and with this we have the output velocity. This is a little complex to explain, but if you have doubts you can ask me after the presentation. Well, with all this work I have explained already, we can go to the pressure drop. The pressure drop is the pressure we need to pump out the material at the velocity that is it is required. We see here in the equation, in the big equation, The delta P is the difference of pressure between the entrance of the nozzle, that is represented here in the left, and in this equation we found a couple of data I commented before. One is the yield stress, that is here in the X, and the X afterwards is present in all the equation for calculate this pressure drop. And the other one is the consistency constant key. Okay, we have here is an analytical model that comes from the paper I showed you before with the results of the deuterium. And these A5, A6, A2 are constants, while the other ones, well, the V0 also is a constant. This is temperatures, and the point is that depending on these temperatures, we can calculate these two values of the yield stress and the consistency constant. For if you don't remember where it comes, just to make a little refresh, we have these two values, the key and the other one is the yield. Then these two values in combination with the geometry of the nozzle, like the diameter D and the length of the nozzle L, can give us the pressure we need to produce in the injector to pump out the material at the required velocity in the set temperature. Well, after this, I make a technology analysis to see which system of extrusion is better for the case of deuterium-tritium at the large, let's say, large volume flows and the temperatures I estimated. We have here three models that already have been used for fusion devices. One is a piston, the other one is a single screw that pump the material by rotation, and the last one that is more promising is the twin screw extruder. We have here what are the advantages and disadvantages for our case in demo. For example, the piston has high costs because the parts are multiple pistons, and also probably will need a lot of replacement for produce this large amount of flux, and they don't produce the injector, the mass injection in a continuous way. So we want something more fast. Then we go to the next level, that is the single screw that has high frequency, long periods on extrusion of deuterium and hydrogen. These 15 and 60 Hertz come from pellets for fueling and pellets for L mitigation that usually are smaller. And we see that this model, for example, matches the ITER requirement, but for demo, we need to go one step ahead. And then we found the twin screw extruder that has all that we need for the large amount of flux. And the only problem, or the big problem it has, is the high shearing between the screws, because this high shearing produces heat, and this heat make more difficult to get frozen the material. But the other good points that it has is like it produces fast frozen, it has positive pumping, so the material at the end of the extrusion has more pressure than in the start, has no stalling problems, has a better mixing because the movement of the two screws, and the two screws has in some way a self-cleaning systems because the threads of the screws are one put inside the other, so one screw clean the gaps of the other. We can see it better here in the image. This is an example of one experiment for fusion where the twin screw extruder was employed with deuterium and hydrogen, and we can see here in the plot the lines correspond to different estimation, theoretical estimations of the temperature along the axial location. The 3 points we can see, it represents the results of the measurements in the experiment with these twin screw extruders. And as we can see, it doesn't match really good the theoretical prediction. But this is good for us because this makes a start point where we can approximate the theoretical simulations of the temperature using the results of this experiment. So this is an improvement of the analytical model at the end, in the particular case of the temperature, because of course there is many points. Well, then I start with the simulation process. For the simulation process, it has like 3 parts, like the every simulation process. We have some inputs that I have defined, the inputs I commented for the mass flow, the output diameter it will require depending on the geometries of the pellet, that is also related with the frequency of the pellets, the temperature that the material go in, the temperature that the material go out. This can be changed in the algorithm. And the algorithm, using these inputs, what it does is define an environment, like the materials it is going to be used in the extrusion. It looks for the better diameter of the screws. If it requires larger geometries of the piece of the screws, it look for the optimal design. Also, it plays with the speed of the rotation of the screws because of these problems of the shearing forces. The barrel temperature also plays a role. It cannot be lower than 5 Kelvin because the coolant of this barrel where the screws are in, it's going to be liquid helium at 4.2 in the supercritical phase. And about this barrel will be made of copper. This copper has better thermal conductivity it will have. The transmission of the temperature of the cold temperature of the helium to the material will be better. And also it takes in account the torque of the screws, because if you get too cold material, then it can be a problem to extrude this material if it gets in a crystal way where the screws cannot rotate anymore, and it has like a definition of a critical torque depending on the dimensions of the screws, the material, etc. And after check many options on geometries and these characteristics of operation, it gives you this set of outputs that are the rotation speed, the torque, the screw dimensions, and the barrel temperature that this barrel should be for produce the output temperature you set in the inputs. Well, this is the result with all these inputs I have defined before. This is a scaled piece made with ANSYS, with the geometries I obtained from the simulation. We can see here the diameter, the number of chambers where the material is going to flow, the length of the screw, the barrel temperature, it means the temperature that the copper should be for extrude the material, in this case at 14 Kelvin, and the speed that the screws are going to be rotating. And then, after I have this result, I am going to analyze the results of my simulation. So using these outputs, I will play with the inputs, with the parameters and the data I look forward, I research, I estimate. I'm going to perform some variations depending on the error of these data, And if we have 10 parameters, then I will play going with some errors up, some errors down, making combinations in the inputs and see what happened in the outputs and how is the deviation. For example, in the length, if the thermal conductivity decreases 20%, that is expected error, let's say. This is just an example. And then with all these parameters combinations up and down going in the inputs, we obtain a number of 1,000 outputs, and we are going to check which is the outputs that goes worst, let's say, from the initial case. So the most differentiated outputs from the ideal case to the errors, taking care of the errors. And I did this with the deuterium in a pure mixture of deuterium, in a pure mixture of tritium, and in a pure mixture of DT. That is not going to be possible in the reality, but just to see and compare if the worst case of the parameters match between the three elements, the three molecules. Then I include these worst cases for each part of the molar fraction, and I use the worst case scenario to see how the, let's say, simulation can vary if all goes wrong, if every error goes in the wrong way and everything goes in the very worst case, the difference between the first calculation and the afterwards calculation will be this. These are the deviations. The length, for example, will increase in practically 4 times. The barrel temperature will decrease, so it shouldn't be lower to produce the same temperature in the output of the material, and the nozzle pressure should increase. And what I found in the parameters is that we have some common factors that affect to the three molecules, that are that the solid thermal conductivity decrease a lot. This is also because the error is very big, and this comes from the research I did and the comparison from one function to other results I have been studying. And this error is very critical. And the next errors, let's say more critical, are the shear strength that can vary at 5% and the solid density. In the case of the solid density, it affects more because of the pressure, for example, and other points. Well, then, for example, because of the length variation is the most important deviation, I'm going to show here what happened if we will have ideal case where we have in our material a pure deuterium material or pure DT or pure tritium. In the case of the blue line, we see that for achieve the 14 Kelvin, we just need 20 centimeters of screw length. But if we want to do the same with the tritium, we need a length in our device of almost 80 centimeters. The reason of this is because the shear strength. The shear strength in the tritium is higher, and then when it becomes solid, it produces more heat. And this heat makes the extrusion more difficult and the cool down more difficult. So then you need a larger process to reach bit by bit the temperature you want. With very slow frozen, let's say, very slow decrease of temperature. And the other two lines, just to comment, the yellow line represents the deuterium-tritium, like a pure deuterium-tritium in an ideal case. And the black line is the real deuterium-tritium, taking in account this molar fraction of the 25-25-50. The dashed lines correspond to the temperature in the barrel. I mean, the temperature in the barrel at the start point where the material is liquid is going to be higher, and then because of the exchange of heat, the temperature of the barrel is going to decrease. This barrel is the wall that is surrounding the screws. So to sum up, the conclusions are that the twin screw extruder is the best technology for the case of demo, better than the single screw and the piston. And it has high accuracy to predict the temperature because the results I have found in the literature and in the experiments. And in the case of the model I did, the design and the simulation, it has the largest impact on the output because of the solid thermal conductivity, that it is not already well measured or accotated in the errors, because it has long errors. And this produced that the most sensible value of my algorithm would be the screw length, that varies till 4 times more, only changing the errors of the characteristics. So this is all, and thank you for your attention. Questions?
Yeah. Thanks, Jose, for the presentation. So, Robin, do you have any questions?
I had a question. I don't remember from the defense. Is your work continued? Like, I mean, will other people work on it? Will it be continued? Or if it isn't, how would you think it could be extended?
Well, the point is already nobody is interested in continue my work because already it's a prevention work, let's say. Because in the case they should make one extruder, they will continue my work, but it's just for set the basics and the environment, or let's say the considerations they should take care for make the design. But I am improving the code and the simulation by my own, implementing some new data I have found and some experimental data that can define better the part of the pressure, because the temperature already, as I showed, is very well defined. It is like a complex system of energy exchange between the wall and the material. But for example, about the pressure, it is more complex because it has lakes because of this pressure in the end of the extrusion. And these lakes are not taking account for the simulation. So I am working in the way to take in account these leakages that go with the flow back, as a kind of flow back, and then requires more velocity or more pressure or different dimensions to produce this final output that we want. So I am working by my own, totally independently.
Okay, and maybe a follow-up question, just because I'm interested. What are your own plans? Do you already have something in mind? Or are you looking for specific positions?
I didn't apply already nothing, but I am just working on this, and I prefer to finish this, and afterwards I will look for. But it's very open already.
Let's see, but people pick up the presentation on YouTube or social media and they contact you. So.
Yeah, it would be nice. But yeah. Of course, I would like to still in the field of fusion. And if it is more focused on commercial and more in the private way, better. But I cannot say nothing because I don't know.
Okay.
Okay, Jose, I have one question on page 18.
18?
Yeah.
Here. Yeah, this is a little bit complex.
You said like you find like at the end you have 30 parameters.
Yeah, I can explain this. Because for example, I mean, if I come from this slide, this is the characteristics, let's say, no?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. All these characteristics has some errors in the measurements they do for deuterium, for hydrogen, for, you know?
Uh-huh, okay.
And then these errors go even wronger or worse when I extrapolate it, you know?
Mm-hmm, okay.
So then these errors, I take it in account for each part of the mix. And taking these errors, I have 10 parameters for deuterium that are the same parameters for tritium and DT, but are not the same functions.
Okay.
So then these parameters, I vary the parameters taking care of the error. If the error is plus minus 5, then mm-hmm. I make the simulation, the total simulation again, but only changing one parameter with minus 5%, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And I permute this in the 10 parameters for all the cases that are 2 by 10, that is the 1,000 cases. And I do this on deuterium functions, on tritium functions, and on DT functions.
So you literally do like 3,000 simulations for 3 years?
Yeah, 3,000 simulations. And after I have this, because I make it in a matrix at the end, I just transform my script in a function, and then I put a loop of the function till I have a matrix. And in this matrix, I found the larger deviation of the outputs.
Mm-hmm.
And this larger deviation, I go to that line and see, okay, this go up. For example, the solid thermal conductivity, that is this K, mm-hmm. go down in the case that the deviation is larger. And then I note, okay, and this is a common point that occurs in the larger deviations, you know?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And in this way, then I can see what are the most sensible characteristics in the simulation.
Okay, okay. Yeah, now I understood, yeah. And I have one more thing on page 10.
Yeah.
On page 10, there is...
Oh, okay, sorry. Page 10, here, yeah.
Mm-hmm. So this is the analytical model for hydrogen and deuterium. So for tritium, you just extrapolate from this model.
Yeah, that is the point. And this was a very complex thing because I had read a couple of papers from Litzmann, this mm-hmm. Professor, Dr. Paul. He make a very good work on this, and thanks to him I have this very nice simulation on the shear strength, on the temperature, and he did a very good job. I mean, I was following all his job on this topic
mm-hmm.
and was really deep, and thanks to this kind of analytical models
mm-hmm.
I have been able to simulate with high precision, for example, the temperature along the extruder.
Okay. Okay.
And this, for example, the T is the melting temperature and the TM. Sorry.
So you extrapolate for tritium from hydrogen, actually. You take the model for hydrogen.
Yeah.
And then you extrapolate to tritium.
Yeah. And with these two, the deuterium and hydrogen, because you need two... let's say data to make a third one in the method I use is the quantum parameter method.
Mm-hmm.
And for use this quantum parameter, you need it depending on the mass of the atoms.
Mm-hmm.
And using the temperature and the same conditions of two atoms, and in this case is valid for hydrogen and the isotopes. And for example, you have the deuterium, you have the hydrogen, you have the masses of both. And with these masses and the temperatures where they are in the same, let's say, thermodynamical state or pressure temperature state, you can calculate how it will be the tritium or the DT.
Okay, okay. Yeah, so I have one more final question. and which is actually on, there's a slide on advantages and disadvantages for the three.
Yeah, the technology analysis.
Yeah. So how can we say like the single screw need high supply pressure, but that's not the case for the twin screw, which needs low supply pressure?
Because, yeah, this is, I commented on twin screw, but not on single, because the twin screw, because of the shape of the chambers it has where the material is housed, it has like a continuous pump out and the pressure goes in a gradient, let's say, and in the point where it is pumped out, it has very large pressure because these chambers are kind of closed and then are growing up the solid, and at the end has more pressure that is better for form the solid. But in the case of single screw, because it's only one screw, it is an open channel, you know, in the gap of the screw. And this open channel requires pressure in the inside inlet, the beginning of the circuit.
Okay.
So when it is rotating, it is moving the mass, the material, but it needs some pressure in the top, in the start, in the beginning of the circuit, to pump out in the exit, in the bottom, let's say. And this is the reason because it requires high pressure. Because for example, if you require in the nozzle, in the injector point, injection point, 5 megapascals, in the twin screw extruder, you can, for example, start in the input at 2 megapascals, and then the pressure go up till 5. This is only an example, it's not accurate.
Okay.
But for example, in the single screw, if you want 5 megapascals in the tube of the nozzle, maybe you need 10 megapascals in the input of the extruder.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah, perfect, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, so let's finish the talk. So, and I thank Jose for your talk. And let's meet in 2 weeks for the next Fusion EP talk.
Okay, thank you.